Hi, my name is Simon Howard and I'm a solution architect at Microfocus. So this video is all about scanning code in Visual Studio. To do that, you need to install our Visual Studio extension and it will appear as a menu item in Visual Studio. Now this is an ASP.NET project with C# and ASP.NET code. So to scan the code, what I need to do is to select from the menu item Fortify Analyze solution. But before I do that, I'm going to look at the options that are available to me. So a dialog will appear in a second, and in this dialog, and I'm going to resize this, there are a number of options available to me. There's a server configuration area where I can define where I get my updates from. So you normally you can just use the default that you see here, and I can test that connection too. Also, there is an ability for me to define where my software security center is if I have that in my installation. In the security content management area, then I basically can see all the rules that I have currently installed on my machine. I can also import rules if I'm using an air gap machine, or I can also update directly from this dialog and connect to the Fortify backend and get those rules. Now in this area, the project settings area, there are three tabs available to me. In the analysis configuration tab, I can define a type of SQL code I'm going to scan, if that's okay, if I'm scanning SQL code, the amount of memory I want to allocate to the scan, Java, basically on the heap, if you like. And also I can see the rules I'm going to use for the scan. Now normally you'll just leave it as you see here and use all the rules, but you can basically define a set of rules that you want to use, and sometimes that's beneficial to make scans slightly quicker. In the Advanced Scan Options tab, I can see that the command line that's going to be used with Fortify SCA, which actually does the scan under the hood, or I can check that box here and I can specify some additional translate or scan stage options that I want to use. I'm just going to leave it as is in this video. Additionally, there's also the ability for me to enable a quick scan as well. In the synchronization options tab, there's the ability for me to find some settings that define how I synchronize my projects. So I'm going to leave that as is. So to do the scan, let's go to it right now. I select Fortify Analyze solution. Then I go through a set of stages, the translate basically and the analysis stage. Now right now we're getting intermediate files. And you'll see the output appear from Fortify in the translation and analysis stage in the output window. And you can see that the translation is now running. We're still getting the intermediate files. In a moment that will complete. There are actually two projects in this solution, a basically unit test project and some additional code. Now we're loading the next stage now, which is the start of the analysis. We're loading some build session environment, some rules, now we're building up the analysis model. There's basically a set of stages you go through as part of the scanning process. Now, as this scan is occurring, your interaction with the Visual Studio IDE is actually blocked, if you like. So, this is just one way of doing a scan. Typically, you do this periodically as you're developing your code, checking out the changes you've made. So we're now going through the other stages in this scan. And now we're finishing off. Okay. When the scan is completed, the IDE, the view, will change. You'll see a set of windows appear in a second. Okay, so now you'll see there are a set of windows. We've got an analysis results window, analysis evidence, and also an area over here with several tabs. So first thing we're going to change the filter set to security auditor view, which gives a better view. And you can see we can categorize the information in several different ways, including OWASP top 10, but we'll keep it as category. Also, any vulnerability is categorized into four groups: critical, high, medium, and low. We can also look at all the issues in one go if we want to, but we'll go back and look at the critical issues. So I know, for example, there are 14 SQL injections that have been found, and we're going to go and look at one of them. So in the details area here, if I click that and I select an actual vulnerability, expand this little plus here, then you can see the text has changed in the details window, and you can see in this area details about this particular vulnerability. Now the format is always the same. There'll be an abstract and an explanation, and then basically some code snippets in the form of examples in the language that has been scanned. So in this case we're looking at a code file which is basically C#, I think. And right at the bottom down here, then you'll see information about this particular vulnerability. So each vulnerability has a signature. We call that the instance ID. And also there's a rule ID shown here, which is the particular Fortify rule that found this issue. Let's go back up to top. And now this column here, the analysis evidence, shows you the data and call flow history leading up to the vulnerability. And if I select that, then I can see the vulnerability occurred at line 86. It's a SQL injection, right? What I would typically do is work backwards through time to the top to see where the vulnerabilities start. And as I select these links, I go to the different parts of my code, even if it's different code files. And you can see here where the SQL injection started. I'm not going to go through that in this video. That's beyond the scope of this. And in this area here, we can see different information about each type of vulnerability. I know, for example, I can see straight away that I haven't triaged any of these vulnerabilities. I haven't suppressed them or created any information about it. Let's go look at the recommendations tab. So typically, when you're looking at a vulnerability, you understand, well, what do I need to do to fix this? So the recommendation tab gives information in the language that was scanned and about how you would fix this type of vulnerability and some tips. And at the bottom, you see a list of references out to the different standards or other documentation that would apply. And this can help you in the triage process. And then there's also a diagram you can look at. So this information directly ties into the call and data flow history in the analysis evidence. But you can see the different modules or components involved in this. It's a little bit like a state transition diagram in UML, a little bit like that. In the summary tab, then you can basically do all sorts of things. So one use case here might be, I want to flag this as being an exploitable issue. I'm pretty sure it is an exploitable SQL injection. So I can add a note in here to say that we need to look at this. I need to put whatever I want to, really, and that will be tracked within the result. So I can add that, and there it goes added to the system now. It tracks when it was added as well. Optionally, I could also file a bug. I could have linked this into a bug tracker, or I could suppress this issue. If I suppress it, it will not appear again. In the filters area, then basically I can define filters that move different vulnerabilities of different types or individual vulnerabilities between one category and another, say critical to high. I might recategorize the type of vulnerability, or I can use it to suppress vulnerabilities. And then once I've done that, I can still see those vulnerabilities by selecting items here, so I could show suppressed items, for example. And that's it for now. I'll see you again in the next video.